Macmillan Audio presents Don't Look for Me by Wendy Walker. Read for you by Thérèse Plummer. Day 1. The sky grows dark as I drive. I tell myself to concentrate, to focus on the two narrow lanes of smooth black asphalt and the double yellow lines that divide them. The road feels like a tunnel, carved between walls of brown cornfields which flank the road on both sides and go on as far as the eye can see. Darkness now hovers above and below and from side to side. It's everywhere. I hear the woman on the radio talk of the storm, but she is muted by thoughts that will not relent as the events of this terrible day unravel in my mind. This stretch of Route 7 passes through an endless chain of small New England towns. Not the quaint villages farther south, but the old industrial hubs that have been left to decay. Neglected farmland, dilapidated houses, abandoned factories. They stand like tombstones. I wonder where people live, where they buy groceries, where they work and go out to dinner, why they don't leave. The unease causes my shoulders to rise and my back to straighten. It's the same every time I pass through. These towns will haunt me well into the night. There's a gas station up ahead, the Gas and Go. It sits at the intersection of Route 7 and an eerie road that leads to the heart of one of these towns. I have never been down that road, and I don't ever intend to. Still, this seems to be the spot where outsiders find themselves in need of gas as they journey from southern Connecticut into western Massachusetts. There must be half a dozen boarding schools and small colleges which are accessed from Route 7. Sometimes I recognize cars, even faces, when I have to stop. And I will have to stop today. The gas light has been on for miles now. After the Gas and Go, it's 2 hours to my home at the southern end of the state. I have already passed the green welcome sign. Welcome to Connecticut. Home. It will be just after 9. My husband John will likely be out. At the gym, at work, having drinks with a friend. My daughter, Nicole, will also be out somewhere. Anywhere that's not near me. She just turned 21, so she has options now. Options that keep me up at night, watching the clock, listening for the door. The dogs will bark and jump on my coat. They'll only want food. They save their affection for my husband. He was the one who brought them home after Annie died, so they've been his dogs more than mine. The house will smell like fantastic and lavender dryer sheets because it's Thursday, and on Thursday the cleaners come. I wonder if they'll remember to clear the ashes from the fireplace in our bedroom. It's late October and cold enough for a fire. John likes to sit in bed with the fire burning while he watches television. He had one going last night. He was asleep by the time I made it up the stairs, though now I remember that the fire had a fresh log. Conclusions are quick to follow, and one hand now covers my gaping mouth. Am I too sensitive? Am I just being too me? Too Molly? I hear these thoughts with John's voice. Stop being so Molly. He has come to use my name as an adjective that allows him to dismiss me. But no, I'm not wrong about the log on the fire. He was pretending to be asleep. The day unravels and I can't stop my thoughts. My son, Evan, attends one of the boarding schools off this road. He was recruited as a freshman to play football. He's a junior now and a starting lineman this season. I make this trip every other Thursday to watch his home games. The season is half over and they are leading the ranks. They may win the entire league this year. The drive is 4 hours each way. John tells me I'm crazy to make the trip twice a month. He tells me Evan doesn't care. Nicole has harsher words for me. She tells me Evan doesn't want me there. that I embarrass him by going, that he's not a little boy anymore. And he doesn't need his mommy watching him play. He has changed. She's right about that. He knows the power he has on the field. I hadn't seen it before today. It was in his stance, his walk. It was in his eyes. And it was in his cruelty. I wonder when that began. If it's new, or only new that I can see it. I waited for him outside the field house where the team enters the locker room. I picture him now as the day plays out again, slowly, painfully. How he walked with his friends, the enormous bag hanging over his shoulder, high tops unlaced, baseball hat turned backward, and a mischievous smile that probably had something to do with talk about a girl. In that moment, before his eyes caught sight of me and his face changed, I felt my heart fill with pride. These thoughts come, and like the log on the fire, they don't go. Oh, my boy, my sweet Evan, the easy middle child, walking like he owned the world. A smile pulled clear across my face as I waited for his eyes to turn and see me at the door. And they did turn. And they did see. And then they widened and looked away. He grew closer, and still, they did not return to me. He positioned himself between two of his friends and passed through the door, leaving me in awe of his dismissiveness. It is just now, 111 miles later, that I feel the bite of it. My vision blurs. I wipe away tears. Christ, I hear John. Stop being so Molly. He's a teenager. But the thought won't leave, this image of his back turned as he walked into the building. I look up at the dark clouds stirring in the sky and see the sign for the Gas and Go sitting atop a giant pole. The storm is a hurricane. I am driving right into its path. John said this was another reason I shouldn't make the trip today. The school could cancel the game if the storm got too close, and even if they didn't, I would surely run into it on the way home. The storm, Evan not caring, and Annie. He stopped short of saying it, but the words lingered between us. Today is the anniversary of her death. 5 years ago, on this day, we lost our youngest child. She was 9 years old. No, I will not think of Annie. I will not go backward. I will go forward. Put one foot in front of the other. I learned this in grief counseling. I used to be a middle school science teacher where the focus is on learning to analyze problems by breaking them down into pieces and forming hypotheses. So I studied the grief this way, objectively, clinically. We are not wired to witness the death of a child, to endure it, to survive it. But like every other human defect, we have used science to outsmart our own biology. We can take a brain that is shredded ear to ear and we can put it back together with mantras like this one. Mantras that have been tested in clinical trials, vetted in peer articles and TED Talks, and now appear in self-help books. You just put one foot in front of the other, Molly. Every day, just one more step. Had I not had other children to care for, I would not have been able to take these steps. I would have died, let myself die, found a way to die. The pain was not survivable. And yet I survived. Forward. But the day continues to unravel, back now to the morning. Nicole was just coming in from one of her nights. I don't know where she slept. Her skin has gone pale, her hair long and unruly. She has become lean from running. She runs for miles and miles. She runs until she is numb, head to toe, inside and out. Then she sleeps all day, stays out all night. She is a lean, fierce, unruly warrior. And yet the pain still gets inside her. Where have you been all night? I asked. The usual exchange followed, about how this was none of my business. But it was my business because she's living in my house, and what about her GED class and trying to dig herself out of this hole? But it's my fault she's in the hole. She's in the hole because of Annie and her grief, and because not everyone can just get over it. But when is she going to stop using her sister's death as an excuse for getting expelled from her private school senior year? Never going back? She shrugged, looked me straight in the eye. When did she become like this? This soldier, ready to fight off anyone who comes too close. What about you? When are you going back to work? She asked. She likes to remind me that I, too, stopped living. Breathing, yes, but not really living. I had no response to my daughter this morning. I had no response to my son this afternoon. I didn't even see Evan after the game. I waited by the door, but he must have gone out a different way. I almost marched straight to his dorm to tell him what I thought of his behavior, to do what a mother does when she knows she's right and when her child needs to learn a lesson. The sign for the gas and go grows closer, the clouds darker as these thoughts come. I didn't find him. I didn't do what I now think a mother should have done. A good mother. Suddenly, I know why. The car slows. I step on the gas, but it doesn't respond. I am not a good mother. I can't hold them back now, the thoughts of my dead child, Annie. Not that they ever really leave me. They are always lurking, hiding, wearing disguises so I don't see them as they sneak up. I steer to the shoulder. The wheel is stiff. The car is dead. When it stops, I try the ignition, but it won't turn over. I see the message on the dashboard. I have run out of gas. How long has the light been on? I have been preoccupied by this day, by these thoughts. John was right. I should not have made this trip. Not today. I look down Route 7 and see the entrance for the station. It can't be more than 30 feet. The wind whips hard, rocking the car. I can see the rain coming on an army of clouds, a blanket closing over the sky. I can't tell how far away they are. How much time I have. Thoughts exploding, heart pounding. What have I done? Now comes the thought about the fire last night. We have four fireplaces in our house, all of them wood burning. I have been making fires and stoking fires since we moved there 12 years ago. I know what a log looks like when it's just been placed on top of the flames. I have no umbrella, just a flimsy jacket. I put it on anyway. I reach for my purse and tuck it inside. It's only 30 feet. I open the door, get out, close it behind me, and I run, clutching the purse. I run into the wind, which is more powerful than I imagined. I run and think about that log which had just been put there last night on the fire. John wasn't asleep. John was pretending to be asleep so he wouldn't have to see me, even just long enough to say goodnight. It's not the first time. Flashes of the fight with Nicole break free as my body pushes through the wind. We fight every day now. Open your eyes! The fight had been so fast and furious I had not processed each word, but I do now. They are open! I see you clear as day, Nicole! Not to me, to your own husband. I can't see what's right in front of me. He never comes home for dinner. He pretends to be asleep when I come into our bedroom. My husband doesn't love me anymore. My husband loves someone else. This thought feels old, like a jagged stone I've been carrying in my coat pocket, trying to rub it smooth. But no matter how much I dig my fingers in, the edges never soften. And then, the words I had not heard before, but had felt many times, still hearing them from my own daughter, twisted the knife. I hate you! Tears fall as I run. Annie, wispy blonde hair resting on delicate shoulders, big round eyes and long lashes. I can still feel her in my arms, her life just beginning. Annie. And now I know why the thoughts have all come. They have been leading me to this one last thought, this naked admission. I am not a good mother because I did not drive 4 hours to watch my son play football so that he would feel loved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.